Alright, so yesterday we started looking at sequential elements, and the first type of sequential element that we looked at was something which just has a control signal, a data input and a data output. Okay, and the idea is when this control signal is equal to 1, the output directly gets the value from the input. When control signal is equal to 0, Q retains its state. That is to say, the last value that was seen at the input is what is going to show up at the output. Okay? And similarly, we saw that there is another kind of sequential element related to this, very similar. But over here, the control signal is such that when it undergoes an edge from 0 to 1, right, at this point Q will take the value of D, otherwise Q retains state. Okay. So in other words, this is level trigger, right? Whenever C hits the value 1 and takes the value 1 as a level, it will become transparent. Right? Whereas this is edge triggered. That is to say, when the control signal undergoes a transition from 0 to 1. Okay? In this case, we take only the 0 to 1 transition. 1 to 0 transition is not considered valid, or rather is not used for the purpose of transferring data from input to output. Okay? So these are the two main types of sequential elements that we have, right? Now, based on this, there is also a lot of other terminology. So I am just stating some of the terminology that as the way that we will be using it in this course. Okay? In general, such kind of things where you have level trigger, we will call these latches. Okay, so when I use the word latch, for the most part, what I mean is a level triggered latch. However, it could also sometimes be used for any kind of sequential element, right? Anything which holds data. Okay, mostly it will be clear from the context, but if we are trying to sort of specifically say which type of element we are dealing with, then a latch typically means level trigger. Okay, whereas this edge trigger is called a register. Okay, now this is not completely standard terminology in the sense that sometimes you will use the word latch being used for something which is edge triggered. You will sometimes use the hear the word edge triggered latches, right? So there's a lot of mixing and matching of terms that you will come across when you read the papers on this that use these items, or even books that are talking about them. Okay. So mostly it will be clear from the context. The symbols at least are fairly clear. When you have that small triangle over there, it indicates the edge. If you don't have the triangle, typically it indicates a level triggered unit, whatever it is, right? Latch or flip-flop or register, whatever you want to call it. Okay. Another term that we will be using throughout is this term flip-flop. Okay. Sometimes just we use the word flop, okay, to indicate what it is that we are talking about over here. Now a flip-flop could be any one of these things. In general, a flip-flop just indicates a device which is capable of holding one of two states. Okay. What I mean by that is either its output can be at 1 or the output can be at 0, and in general, even if you take the input away, it will retain that state. Okay. So the difference between an inverter and a flip-flop, for example, is that in the case of the inverter, if I remove the input, if I disconnect it, the input goes floating, then I can no longer say what the output is going to be. Okay? Because the input can float, it can basically change its value. Based on that, the output will change to reflect whatever it is. Whereas in a flip-flop, once even if I remove the input, right, I will see that the output remains either as a static 0 or a static 1. It will retain its state. Okay? So a flip-flop is pretty much anything that can retain, or rather that can switch between states. Okay. So the first question that we can ask is, how would I implement something of this sort? What is it that I'm trying to do? I have, let's say, an inverter. Remove the input or disconnect the input. So the input is floating, output is undefined. Undefined meaning that there is no clarity on whether it's going to be a 0 or a 1. Okay? Because if the input floats away from VDD and basically reaches somewhere around VDD by 2 or so, the output will also float away. Okay? So in that sense, the inverter does not hold its state. It's not that if I disconnect the input, it will just remain at whatever last value it had. For some time it will, of course, because there is a capacitance associated with it. The voltage is not instantaneously going to change. But over time, it can drift away. Okay? So what we want instead is, let's say I have an inverter, right? I want something which, even if I disconnect the input of the inverter, will still retain its state. So in other words, if the inverter was currently showing a 1 at its output, that is, it had a 0 at the input, I want it to remain that way, that the output remains at 1. Okay? And one of the simplest things I can think of to do something like that is, how do I get an inverter to show an output of 1 by feeding in a 0 to it? Okay? So how do I ensure that I can feed in a 0 when I want the output to be a 1? You take whatever is the output, invert it and feed it back to the input. Okay? So in other words, you create this kind of a structure. Okay? So what have I done with this? I have essentially created a feedback loop of two inverters. Okay? Typically, this is referred to as a back-to-back inverter configuration. So what has happened over here is, let's say that this was equal to 0, this output will be 1. The second inverter sees an input of 1, it generates an output of 0, both inverters are happy. Okay? If the opposite was the case, that is this was at 1 and this was at 0, then once again the second inverter sees a 0 as input, generates a 1 at output, again both inverters are happy. Okay, they will remain there as long as you supply power to the system. Okay? And effectively what I'm saying is, my input over here is effectively, I don't care what it is, it is going to retain whatever state it has. There are still some big question marks over here. For example, how can you connect an input? Because effectively it would mean, if I connect an input there, there will be two things driving that common point. Okay, how do I resolve that? How do I make sure things don't go wrong? How do I see to it that this will actually function the way I want to? Those are the challenges for actually implementing latches. Okay. But the core idea of something that can retain state can be achieved using this configuration, two inverters back to back. Okay? What do they look like? What is functionally, what does it mean to convert and to connect two inverters back to back? Effectively what we are saying is, I'll call this VI, I'll call this VO. Okay? This is I1, this is I2. Okay. I can draw a voltage transfer characteristic of I1. Okay. So this will be VI on the x-axis, VO on the y-axis. It will look something like this. Okay. Now, what is I2 seeing? It is seeing VO as the input and VI as the output. Okay, it need not be an identical inverter, but it will still have an inverter type of characteristic. Okay, the interesting thing about it is, now it is seeing VO as the input and VI as the output, which means on the same axis with inputs and outputs interchanged, I can plot the voltage transfer characteristic of I2. Okay, it will be something else, something which looks like this. It need not be identical, keep that in mind. There is no requirement that it be identical to the previous one. Okay? But it will have some kind of a characteristic like this, because I need to sort of, you know, turn to the by 90 degrees, look at what it is, flip VO and VI, and I'll see that this is in fact what the inverter characteristic looks like. Okay. this is sort of like what we might have done earlier in so-called load line analysis, right? You essentially take the characteristics of two circuit elements, right? Match up the voltages, plot them on the same graph, and the intersections essentially tell you what is going to be the operating point of the circuit. So in this case, what we are seeing is there are three possible operating points, three intersections between these curves, right? One of them is over here, another one is at this other end, and the third one is right here in the middle. Okay? If you look carefully at these operating points, right, what you will find is, let's consider this one. I'll call them P1, P2, P3. At P1, right, Vi is equal to 0, Vo is equal to VDD. Okay? Let's consider what happens if Vi changes a little bit away from from 0. So it increases slightly, Vi increases slightly, maybe some noise or something happens to disturb the system. Okay? What happens when Vi increases slightly? It goes through I1. Right, because after all, Vi is what is being applied as input to I1 and comes out as Vo. Okay? But if you look at that part of the curve, right, it is essentially this region that we are talking about. Right? A given change in Vi, okay, look at a color. A given delta Vi gives a small delta Vo. Right? Why is that? Because I am looking at the inverter characteristic of I1. After all, the change in Vi was applied to I1 as input. Right? So whatever change I made at Vi goes through I1, comes out as a much smaller change. The delta Vo is going to be much smaller because of the region of the characteristic, right? It's up there. In fact, it's probably going to be 0, but if at all it's anything, it's going to be small, right? What happens? That delta Vo, that small change in Vo, is now applied as input to I2. Okay? What happens to I2? Effectively, what we are saying is, now instead of being exactly at this point, I am now taking this changed value of Vo, this updated value of Vo as input to I2. What will that do? In that case, I will go look at it. Okay, this is the input I am giving. What is the corresponding output that I see? What will happen is I2 will push Vi back towards 0, okay, because it is that region of the characteristic, right? You go now look at the characteristic corresponding to I2 for this value of input voltage, that is Vo. What should be the corresponding value of the output voltage according to I2? What it will say is, oh, if this is the input voltage, this should be the output voltage, right? Vo has changed slightly, but it's saying, okay, Vo has changed slightly, I'm saying Vi should change even less. So Vi changed initially, right, due to whatever outside disturbance, some noise or whatever came into the system. That caused Vo to change as a result of the first inverter I1. That change was already suppressed, reduced. That was in turn fed to I2, which said, I'll suppress it even further, I'll push Vi back towards where it was supposed to be. That is, it was Vi was supposed to be 0, I'll push it back towards 0. So effectively, if you are close to P1, if your operating point is at P1 and you have a disturbance in the input, the two inverters will make sure to push it back to where it started from. Okay? So in other words, what we can say is P1 is a stable operating point. Okay? Same thing happens at P3. At P3, what happens is any change in Vi, so Vi is now close to VDD, right? Let's say it drops slightly, Vo was close to 0, it will increase a little bit, not much because of where the characteristic is. That will then get applied as input to I2 and will get suppressed further. okay, VI will get pushed back towards VD. So P1 and P3, in other words, you can see are sort of stable operating points. What about P2? Right? What happens in the case of P2 is, this is that region of the inverter characteristic where effectively amplification is taking place. Any delta VI that you apply over here comes out as a larger value at VO, okay, because the slope is greater than minus 1, or rather magnitude of the slope is greater than 1. Okay. So for a given delta VI, even a small change, let's say that somehow I have got to a point P2, right? My voltages are carefully adjusted so that somehow VI is equal to, you know, this voltage that is required for holding it at P2. Corresponding to that, I will see some output of I1 that will be applied as input to I2 and come out exactly as VI again. Okay. So in that sense, it is actually stable, right? As long as everything is okay, it will remain at that point. It can remain indefinitely over there. Right? If the voltages remain unchanged, if there is no noise in the system, if everything is perfect and I somehow manage to get it to that voltage, it will remain there. Right? It's sort of like taking a football, balancing a tennis ball on top of it. Right? You can do it. It will remain there indefinitely provided there is no disturbance to it. You keep the football over there carefully, you place a tennis ball on top of it, don't move anything, it will remain there indefinitely. The slightest amount of disturbance, one puff of wind, what will happen? It will start rolling. The moment it moves away from the center, it completely falls apart. That's exactly what will happen here also. Right? Over here, what will happen is the moment there is a change in VI, that will get amplified and come out as a larger change at VO. Now VO is also I2 is also operating in that same region of amplification. So a change in VO gets applied as input to I2, gets amplified and comes out as an even larger change in VI. Okay? In which direction? See, in the other two cases, P1 and P3, if there was a change in VI, the result was trying to push it back towards where it came from. But over here, you'll see that any change in VI will try to push it in the same direction that it changed, meaning that it will make it worse and worse. Okay? And eventually, supposing VI had increased slightly, you will find that it goes and settles at a point of VI equal to VDD, VO equal to 0. If VI had decreased slightly, it will settle to the other point, VI equal to 0, VO equal to VDD. Okay? So P2, in other words, is not a stable point. Okay? The usual word for this is it's something called a saddle point. Like I said, it's sort of like taking one football and balancing a tennis ball on top of it. If everything is okay, then it is actually stable. It can remain there indefinitely. There is nothing to tell you that, you know, after 1 second it will fall or after 1 minute it will fall. It could remain there for days if there was no disturbance. Right? Same way, the inverters, if they are in that configuration where they get stuck at P2, can remain there for arbitrarily long. There is no guarantee that within a certain amount of time it will go to one of the two ends. Okay? This is sometimes called a metastable condition. Right? It is not exactly unstable. Right? What happens over here is, it can remain there, but the slightest disturbance from that point will cause it to move away from there. Whereas proper stability implies that any disturbance will also push it back to the same point. Okay? So metastability is a situation where these two inverters essentially end up at that middle point. Right? Now, in any practical system, including a configuration of two inverters, there will be some noise, right? If not anything else, then at least just Brownian motion or, you know, random thermal noise will be there in the electronic components, right? That will cause some disturbance in the voltage, okay? That disturbance in the voltage will be enough to push it to either side, either slightly increase or slightly decrease. And because of the amplification nature of these two, of this configuration, it will end up pushing the thing to either the VI equal to VDD or VI equal to 0 operating points. Okay? How long will it take to do this? That depends on the amount of noise that is there in the system. It depends on how much is the amplification that is there in that region. That is, in other words, the voltage transfer characteristic. Right? So it depends on a few things that are not really in your control. Right? So in general, it's not possible to say how long a configuration like this can remain at that metastable point. Okay. Because of that, metastability is fundamentally undesirable. It essentially says that you are ending up in a situation where you are not able to say clearly what your operating point is and for how long it will remain. Okay. So what we have, in other words, is we now have a configuration that can retain state, right? We know how to sort of get a circuit which will be able to remember whether its output is supposed to be a 1 or a 0 even after you have removed the input, right? But that circuit, the way we have constructed it, has this one problem of metastability, meaning that if it ends up at that middle point for some reason, you cannot in general predict how long it will take for it to come out of that and settle properly to a logic value being either 0 or VDD. Okay. So this is our basic element, and what we are going to see now is we will accept this fact. We will accept the fact of metastability, right? We can't do anything about it. The question that we are now trying to answer is, all right, if you ignore metastability and assume that, you know, that is something that we need to be careful about, keep in mind, right? But apart from that, the more important question is, how do I use this element? How do I use this flip-flop, right? Which can now switch between two states. How do I actually make it switch between those two states? Okay? So that's the next most important question for implementing a sequential element or a latch. Okay? So here's the thing. If I have this latch, I'll call this D, I'll call this Q. Okay? Let's say that D is equal to 1, Q is equal to 0. Right? How do I change the value? How do I make Q equal to 1? How can I do that? How can I control the way that I change the value of Q to 1? Can you think of any ways by which you can change the value at Q? Obviously, I want to try and apply something which is a known quantity. So I have something else over here, right? I have a signal over here. I'll call it A. I somehow want to get this into this system. So I want A is going from 0 to 1, right? And I want that 1 to get reflected at Q. Sorry, A is not going from 0 to 1. Let me just leave that aside. A is my signal, and you know, whether it's going from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0, I want that to cause a change in Q somehow. Okay, that's a good point. You are allowed to do anything you want. How will you do it? Right, so his question is, are you allowed to disconnect the feedback? That's a very good question. In fact, that is one of the ways that you're going to do it, right? Question is, how will you do it? Forget edge triggered, right? Let's just talk about level triggered at this point, right? So don't worry about edges. Let's just consider a level, right? So that word you used, make it a switch, is the right idea. How will you use a switch in this context?
XOR.
No, you don't care about D, right? I mean, you see, don't worry about the present value of D. I'm saying that whenever I have a separate control signal, I also have C out here. Right? So, what is a switch? The simplest kind of switch is a pass transistor. Right? So, how do I get a pass transistor into the circuit? Okay, so the core idea that we are going to use here is we want to break this feedback loop. Okay? And somehow I want to break the feedback loop for long enough so that some data can get into the loop. Okay? So let me see how I can do that. What I'm going to do is, I'll once again draw this circuit. Right? But now I'm going to say I wanted to break the feedback loop, right? let's break it over here. Put in a switch, a pass transistor. Okay? And at the same time, when that loop is broken, right? Or wait a minute, this is actually the wrong position to put the switch. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put it here. Okay? Because what I'll do is when that feedback loop is broken, I want something else to get inside. I'll put another switch over here and allow A to come in with C as the control. Okay? So what should the other switch be? What should be the controlling input on that? C bar. Okay. So as long as I do this, right, does this work? So what we are saying is, as long as C is equal to 0, right, C bar will be equal to 1, that bottom pass transistor is on, the feedback loop is set up properly. Okay? There is an issue over here, of course, that bottom transistor is a pass transistor. This whole problem with a weak transfer of 1, right? So even when this point output of I2 becomes equal to VDD, the output of that pass transistor will only be VDD minus VT. That's okay. Why? Because even VDD minus VT, if I apply it to I1, it's going to be seen as a logic high, and the output of I1 will become a proper 0. Okay? That's essentially called the restoring property of logic. Okay? Restoring essentially means that even if your input changes a little bit away from your ideal logic value, the output will be closer to the proper logic value. Yeah. D. Well, this point is D. Okay. Correct. So, I mean, I'm saying that that point is D based on the fact that I drew it there in the previous diagram. Strictly speaking, what I said was not quite correct. This should not be D. If I want the value at D to get copied over to Q, right, what I actually need is D should be this. Right? So this extra inverter outside is not really necessary for the functionality. It is just so that the value at D comes through to Q. Otherwise, the value of the input will come inverted to the output. Okay. Mostly, I don't care about these kind of inversions. If it comes through inverted but it stores it correctly, that's perfectly fine because I can take care of the inversion somewhere else. Okay. But if I want that, you know, this signal is what needs to get stored inside the flip-flop, fine, put an inverter at the input, get it stored properly over there. Okay. So now how does this work? Any time that I want to store data into this flip-flop, right, I set the value at D so that it has the correct value that I want. Okay. Set C equal to 1. Automatically C bar becomes equal to 0. The feedback loop will break. The feed forward connection from D to Q will become active. And the data which was placed at D will go through the two inverters and come through to Q. Right? There will be some propagation delay associated with it, right? Two inverters plus one pass transistor. After that has happened, once again I can make C back equal to 0. When I make C equal to 0, that D gets cut off from the two inverters. The feedback loop once again kicks in, and the new value of Q will get stored over there. Okay? So this is one of the most straightforward ways of updating the value in a flip-flop. Right? Essentially, this is breaking the loop. There is one more way which is sometimes used in practice. Can you think of any other way of writing data into this without even using, well, you still need a pass transistor somewhere to control when you write, but without breaking the loop, can you think of any way by which I could change the value at Q? Huh? So a multiplexer is still breaking the loop, right? It is also a form of a switch in some sense. Right? So, one thing that you could do over here is, right, you do the same thing. You essentially say that I will have a multiplexer like this where I put D over here, I put the control signal over here, and I do this. Okay, so this is also achieving exactly the same thing. right? In fact, this is probably a slightly cleaner implementation than the pass transistor, because we essentially have a proper multiplexer in place, right? How would you implement a multiplexer? Probably once again using pass transistors, or maybe transmission gates. We looked at a multiplexer using transmission gates. Okay, but in either case, this is still breaking the loop. Okay, so this will also work, right? You could implement this multiplexer using pass transistors. I'm saying don't break the loop. Connecting Q as the, but I'm still breaking the loop, right? No, no. So what is this configuration you are saying? So I have, so in other words, I have this. I'm not allowed to change this. Okay. This is Q. What you are saying is, okay, going where? Okay. So C is the control to this. Supply A where? No, okay, wait, let's, okay, I'm not sure, so it's not clear where you're saying, where you're going to apply A. So what is the pass transistor doing? I think the idea is right, but it's not entirely clear how you're saying it, right? You do want to apply A directly at Q, or rather D directly at Q, okay? So the basic idea over there is correct. Question is, what do you need to satisfy so that it will actually work and not cause problems, right? So let's just consider this situation, that I take this, right? I want to update the value at Q. What I'm going to do is just put a pass transistor here, because after all I need some form of control, and say that I'll just directly give, you know, I'll call it A and I'll say that its value is equal to D bar, okay? Or, you know, it doesn't matter, or like, yeah, okay, let it be. I could just probably put an inverter over here and say D, right? What will happen when C becomes equal to 1? So what is the difference between this and the previous case? I simply don't have the pass transistor in the feedback loop to break the feedback loop, okay? Will this work? What will happen? Why is that? No, no, what is that? No, 1 to 0 there. What are you saying? 1 to 0 at A. So a 1 to 0 transition at A will result in what? Might not be successful. Why is that? Okay, 0 to 1 transition will not be successful, right? No, no, no. Wait, so let's look at what happens in a pass transistor, right? Supposing C is equal to VDD, A is equal to VDD, this B will become equal to, it will actually increase, it will become VDD, but only VDD minus VT. Okay? On the other hand, if I have C is equal to VDD over here, and A is equal to 0, now B will go all the way down to 0. It will actually be a better one. The pass transistor is good at passing zeros. Okay. Why is that? Effectively, source and drain are switched around. Current will flow from right to left and will discharge completely. Okay? Because C to A is now acting as gate and source, and always you have VGS greater than VT. So the channel is always formed. Current can flow as long as VDS is greater than 0. So until VDS becomes equal to 0, current will continue to flow. Okay. So this configuration, in other words, the pass transistor by itself is okay. It will make sure that whatever you apply at its input will come through to the output, right? So as such, when I have this kind of a configuration, whatever I apply over D goes through this inverter, comes through the pass transistor and comes and sits at, I'll call this point X, okay? But what else is driving X? I2. Okay? So what's happening? Effectively, if I look at x, right, it looks something like this. I'll call this I0. And I have I2. Both are driving x. Okay? Schematic wise, so I have two inverters whose outputs have been shorted together. Question is, what will happen to the voltage at x? Right? Let's say that this, this is Q. Okay? Let's say that D is equal to 0 and Q is equal to 1 to start with. Okay? What is the equivalent circuit that I have in that case with D equal to 0, Q equal to 1? On the left hand side inverter, what is active? Only the PMOS, not the NMOS, right? So the NMOS drops out of the picture. So the left hand side essentially becomes like this. Right hand side, only the NMOS is active, not the PMOS. So this is what I have at X, right? Driving X. How will I decide the voltage at X? Depending on the sizes, right? So now depending on the sizes of that left hand side PMOS and the right hand side NMOS, the voltage at X will change. Okay? What is it that I wanted? I am applying a D equal to 0. From the other side I have Q equal to 1, right? So D equal to 0 is supposed to make Q equal to 0. The question is, can that succeed? For making Q equal to 0, X should become 1, that intermediate point, right? If I look at this circuit over here, if X becomes 1, Q will automatically get forced to 0 because I1 will take over. Okay? So in this equivalent circuit that I have over here on the right hand side, I don't really need to worry about, you know, pulling X all the way up to VDD. I need to pull X to some point such that it can affect that inverter I1. Okay, so if I can choose the sizes of I0 and I2 such that I0 is more powerful than I2, right? More powerful meaning wider transistors, lesser resistance, more current delivering capability, right? Meaning that it's more powerful than I2, it will be able to pull X sufficiently high that X will cause I1 to switch. Okay, and as soon as I1 starts switching, the whole feedback loop kicks in again and we quickly move over to the correct operating point. Okay, so what we have done over here is just pretty much use brute force, right? I have a more powerful inverter. I shot two inverters outputs together, right? Normally a bad idea. Right, both of them are outputs. If I connect them together, one is trying to pull to VDD, the other is trying to pull to ground. That's exactly what is happening here. Right, there is a short circuit for some amount of time, but what will happen is quickly one of the inverters is more powerful than the other. It will pull the voltage sufficiently high that the whole system will switch. Once it switches, that short circuit is broken again. Then everybody is happy once more. There is no instability here. Right, it goes back to a new stable operating point. So I have pretty much just used brute force, right? Sometimes this is also called overpowering the loop. Right? Overpowering basically meaning that you are using strength in order to push something over the other. Okay? This word overpowering you might come across in other places. Be a little careful when you see that word. it is sometimes also used in a different context where we want to sort of just say that we are increasing the power of a particular gate or something like that, increasing the strength of a particular gate. Okay, so it can be a bit confusing if you are not careful about the context in which you see it. But in this case, it's clear. All that we are doing is we say that we have a loop. Without breaking the loop, right? Why do I not want to break the loop? I'm trying to save one pass transistor over there, pretty much. That's what it boils down to. Okay. What's the cost of this? If I don't put that extra pass transistor in the loop, instead of that, I have to make sure that I0 is sufficiently bigger than I2 so that this transition can take place. Okay. I0 has to be big enough that it can pull X to a point where I1 will transition. Okay, if it can do that, then everybody is happy. Okay, so that part needs to be taken care of over here, right? So effectively what we are coming down to, in other words, is these are two straightforward methods by which we can construct latches, right? Both of them are used in order to construct latches, right? What we have over here, this back-to-back inverter configuration, is a static configuration. Okay. A static configuration meaning that I remove the input, that is to say I disconnect that pass transistor that's feeding input in, leave power supply turned on. This will retain its state indefinitely as long as the power supply is on. There are no floating nodes, right? Just like we had in the case of static combinational gates, here also we can call this a static latch, right? Why are we concerned about it? Because obviously there are also dynamic latches that we can think of, right? And dynamic latches are potentially even much simpler than what we have over here, right? Because at some level, the simplest kind of dynamic latch that I can think of is this. Okay? What is that output capacitance? Assume that there is some capacitance over there, right? Effectively what I am saying is, if I make C equal to 1, then if D is 0, then that capacitor will discharge and Q will become 0. If D is 1, the capacitor will charge and Q will become 1. Okay? As simple as that, this acts as a latch. What happens when C is equal to 0? Effectively I have disconnected that Q point from anything that is driving it. On the output side, it will be connected to a gate terminal of some transistor, which means that it is an insulating terminal. No current will flow through that anyway. Okay? So if I disconnect C, or rather if I make C equal to 0 and I disconnect that pass transistor, that value at Q can remain there for as long as it can be sustained by not having leakage take it away from them. Okay? So this is the simplest form of a dynamic latch, right? It looks almost too simple to be true. For the most part it is, because this is not a practical latch for use in regular circuits. On the other hand, DRAM, right? Dynamic RAM, which is the RAM which is used in every one of your computers, right? So when you talk about, you know, your machine has 2 GB RAM or 4 GB RAM, whatever it is, that RAM is talking about the dynamic RAM that you have in the system, right, is built exactly using this technique, right? The entire storage is built around a single capacitor that stores charge and can be, you can use some kind of pass transistor in order to read and write that capacitor. Okay, so this is possible. It is in fact used in some cases in practice. That for building regular latches for use in circuits, it is not a very robust form of design. Okay? Alright, we will stop here for now. What we are going to continue with next is essentially, how do we use these kind of transparent level triggered latches in order to create edge triggered latches, and then look at a few different configurations of latches themselves. What are the different ways in which they can be built, and what are the relative merits and demerits of each. Okay?